Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chanzo. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Wednesday, the 16th of June. Terrorism, radicalization, gravest threats facing world, says India's defense minister at key ASEAN meet. Afghanistan hospitals close doors to new patients as COVID-19 surges. And over a dozen killed as flash floods wreak havoc in Nepal and Bhutan. And now for all the details. Chief Minister of Indian capital New Delhi, Arvind Kejriwal, on Wednesday said that his government will train 5,000 youths as health assistants as part of a plan to deal with the possible third wave of COVID-19. Meanwhile, all federally protected monuments, including the Taj Mahal, reopened for public on Wednesday as authorities rushed to lift restrictions in a bid to revitalize the economy.
Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal on Wednesday said that his government will train 5,000 youths as health assistants as part of a plan to deal with the scarcity of medical and paramedical staff in possible third wave of COVID-19 after the Indian capital faced a deadly second wave. Kejriwal said that these youths will be given basic training in nursing, paramedics, life-saving first aid and home care at Delhi's 9 major medical institutes. They will work as assistants of doctors and nurses after completing their mandatory training, which will begin from June 28 in batches.
मैं समझता हूँ इससे हमारी जो तैयारी है थर्ड वेव की इसको काफ़ी मजबूती मिलेगी और मैन पावर तैयार होगी अगर थर्ड वेव आती है तो मैं फिर से उम्मीद करता हूँ भगवान से कि थर्ड वेव ना आए लेकिन इंग्लैंड से यूके से जो खबर आ रही है कि वहाँ पे थर्ड वेव आ गई है तो हमें भी दुनिया भर में जो डेवलपमेंट्स हो रहे हैं उनको ध्यान में रखते हुए अपनी तैयारी में किसी तरह की कमी नहीं करनी है.
Meanwhile, India's iconic Mughal-era monument Taj Mahal reopened to the public on Wednesday after being closed in early April. As the country, still reeling from a disastrous second wave of the pandemic, rushes to lift restrictions in a bid to revitalize its economy. India's COVID-19 cases tally on Wednesday stood at 29.63 million, while total fatalities surged to 379,573. Other federally protected monuments, including New Delhi's Red Fort and Qutub Minar, were also reopened to tourists on Wednesday, even as alarm bells ring over a resurgence of crowds in major cities that threatens to fuel another spike in infections.
Terrorism and radicalization are the gravest threats to peace and security that the world is facing today. India's Defense Minister Rajnath Singh said in a virtual address at the ASEAN Defense Ministers Meeting Plus on Wednesday. He shared India's views and outlook on the regional and international security environment and called for a free, open and inclusive order in the Indo-Pacific.
India's Defense Minister Rajnath Singh, in a virtual address at the ASEAN Defense Ministers Meeting Plus on Wednesday, said, "Terrorism and radicalization are the gravest threats to peace and security in the world, and a collective approach is required to combat the challenges." Singh called for the strong action against those encouraging, supporting and financing terrorism and provide shelter to terrorists, seen as a veiled reference to Pakistan. ADMM Plus is a platform comprising 10-nation ASEAN, Association of Southeast Asian Nations, and its 8 dialogue partners, India, China, Australia, Japan, New Zealand, Republic of Korea, Russia and the United States.
Terrorism and radicalization are the gravest threats to peace and security that the world is facing today. India shares global concerns about terrorism and believes that in an era when networking amongst the terrorists is reaching alarming proportions, only through collective cooperation can the terror organizations and their networks be fully disrupted.
Indian Defense Minister also called for a free, open and inclusive order in the Indo-Pacific, adding that New Delhi supports freedom of navigation, overflight and unimpeded commerce in the international waterways, including the South China Sea, whose sovereignty is claimed by China. However, several ASEAN member countries, including Vietnam, the Philippines and Brunei, have counterclaims.
Moving on, a massive protest erupted in Pakistan-administered Kashmir recently, demanding the rollback of a job regularization law, which the protesters called discriminatory, exclusionary and suppressive. The protesters accused the government of nepotism and corruption and blamed it was working in line with Islamabad's designs to further oppress people of the illegally occupied region.
A protest was held recently by a score of youths in Muzaffarabad city of Pakistan-administered Kashmir against a discriminatory and suppressive legislation which regularizes an unspecified number of ad hoc, temporary and contractual employees. The protesters raised slogans against the government in Pakistan-administered Kashmir, accusing it of nepotism and corruption, and blamed it has been working to further oppress the people of the illegally occupied region. The recently passed laws addresses the years-long demand of job regularization of contractual workers, but the protesters said that only those who had allegiance or any other form of connection with the ruling Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz Party have got employed.
अपने भांजों भतीजों को अपने रिश्तेदारों को अपने चमचों को नोएडा भर्ती करते हुए आखिरी दिनों में एक ऐसा काला कानून लाया कि रियासत भर के पढ़े लिखे और अहल काबिल नौजवानों के हकूक पर डाटा डाला.
The protesters vowed to continue their demonstration until the law is rolled back or is annulled by the court. They have filed a petition in the High Court challenging the legislation for being inconsistent and in contravention with the occupied region's constitution. Youth in Pakistan-administered Kashmir blame they have long been denied employment systematically over the years. Even Pakistan's National Testing Service, which administers academic performance evaluation tests in Pakistan, does not consider the youth of the region.
A Pakistani court has adjourned till October 5 the hearing of a government's plea to appoint a counsel for Indian death row prisoner Kulbhushan Jadhav on request of the country's top law officer. The Islamabad High Court also issued notice to the Council of Indian High Commission to appear before the court on the next date of hearing. 51-year-old retired Indian Navy officer Jadhav was sentenced to death by the Pakistani military court on charges of espionage and terrorism in April 2017. India had in 2018 approached the International Court of Justice against the denial of consular access to Jadhav and challenging the death sentence. The Hague-based ICJ in July 2019 directed Pakistan to allow consular access to Jadhav and effectively review his death sentence. Meanwhile, Pakistan has last week passed a government-backed bill in the National Assembly that will provide the right of appeal to Jadhav. Though legal experts in India have welcomed the move, however, they expressed concern the law will be meaningless if Jadhav is not allowed a neutral legal help. Moving on to news from Afghanistan. Afghanistan is grappling with a third wave of the pandemic with a record number of infections and deaths being reported. The two main hospitals treating people with COVID-19 in Afghanistan have had to close their doors to new patients because of lack of beds, a senior health official and doctors said on Monday. Afghan capital Kabul's main hospitals were grappling with a surge of COVID-19 patients on Tuesday, as people with empty cylinders gathered outside of oxygen factories hoping to get them refilled. On Monday, two hospitals closed their doors to new patients after running out of beds. Afghanistan is grappling with a third wave of the pandemic with a record number of infections and deaths being reported. On Tuesday, the country reported 1,647 new cases and an additional 78 deaths. As on Wednesday, Afghanistan's total coronavirus cases stands at 93,765 and 3,705 deaths. According to reports, the two hospitals were facing persistent shortages of oxygen and other medical supplies. Family members desperate for oxygen gathered outside the factory with empty cylinders.
پدرم مریض است. شاید یک ساعت یا دو ساعت دیگه اکسیژن داشته باشه. یک بالون خرد آوردیم برشان میگم که این بالون برام پر کنه. شاید هم اکسیژن خلاص شوه. مشکلات به وجود بیاد. دیگه این مشکل زیاد ما داریم. موترای کلان میاد. 40 تا 50 تا بالونای کلان پر میکنن بدون نوبت میرن.
The country has administered about 1 million vaccine doses so far, largely to frontline health workers and members of the security forces. Last week, Afghanistan received 700,000 doses of a COVID-19 vaccine made by China's Sinopharm. In news from Nepal, as the annual monsoon season begins in Nepal, floods and multiple landslides inflicted heavy damage and killed at least 7 people on Wednesday, while several were reported missing. Meanwhile, flash floods also washed away a remote mountain camp in neighboring Bhutan, killing at least 10 people.
At least 7 persons were killed while several went missing in Nepal on Wednesday after floods wreaked havoc across various regions of Sindhupalchok district of the Himalayan nation. Multiple landslides and floods followed the incessant rainfall 5 days after the onset of monsoon and caused heavy damages in Hilambo and Milamchi areas. Bodies of 7 people that were earlier reported missing have been recovered, according to Sindhupalchok District Administration Office. Several others had reportedly gone missing after they were swept away by the Milamchi River, most of them working on site of the Milamchi drinking water project. Meanwhile, flash floods triggered by heavy rains also washed away a remote mountain camp in Bhutan on Wednesday, killing at least 10 people and injuring 5. Both Nepal and Bhutan have been lashed by heavy rains in the last 3 days as the annual monsoon season begins.
More news from Nepal. Nepal police arrested members of a student union affiliated with opposition Nepali Congress Party on Tuesday as they held an anti-government protest denouncing the dissolution of parliament in May. Opposition parties have continued to oppose the move, calling it unconstitutional and anti-democratic.
Members of the Nepal Student Union affiliated with the opposition Nepali Congress Party were arrested by the police on Tuesday as they raised anti-government slogans denouncing house dissolution by caretaker Prime Minister KP Sharma Oli. The protesters demanded resignation of Oli, who also had lost a vote of confidence in the parliament and has managed to continue on the post as caretaker Prime Minister until the elections called for November are held. The police intervened and arrested over half a dozen protesters for flouting COVID-19 prohibitory orders in front of the dissolved parliament. Nepal President Bidya Devi Bhandari had dissolved the House of Representatives in May and announced mid-term elections for November 12 and 19 after neither caretaker PM Oli nor opposition leader Sher Bahadur Deoba were able to demonstrate a majority to form a new government. Opposition parties and constitutional experts have continued to oppose the dissolution move, calling it unconstitutional and anti-democratic. Dozens of petitions challenging the move have also been filed in the Supreme Court.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com. You can also visit us on Facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.